Here they are, Limerick looking to become the first team in 32 years to win three Munster titles in a row. The last team to do it, though, are their opponents today, Tipperary, under the guidance of Babs Keating. We have Donal Logue, Ursula and Henry along for this. Henry and Donal Logue were with me when we were in... People call it monsoon conditions, but that suggests that may have been warm as well. It's very, very different now to their last championship meeting.
Yeah, some contrast, Joanne. It was... I don't think we'll ever forget that day, to be honest. It was freezing rain, it was howling winds, it was right smack bang in the middle of a pandemic, and that was only for the pundits. I'll tell you one thing that I'll never forget about that day was the performance of the players, right? In reality, they were coming almost into like, it was like a laboratory test was the way I felt coming in here. Not to mention for them, they probably didn't even have showers afterwards, but the performance that day of the control, the striking, the exhibition that they gave of hurling, and I think when history is written about the GA's contribution during the pandemic, I think that day is going to be called out in terms of what I describe as almost a defiance from the players and the GA of everything else that was going on around us at the time.
If they can manage to produce what we saw in front of our eyes in those conditions, what can they do in the sunshine with a pitch like that?
I think they can do magic, and that's what Donal Logue is talking about. He's talking about defiance, but as well as that, it's the magic of these two teams. And we've such good ball players on show. The field is just immaculate. It's great to see the umbrellas being used as a shade today instead of in from the covers. It's great to see Donal Logue losing some of the layers of clothing at the last time he was putting on one. So, as I said, it's just brilliant to be here. I was in Croke Park last night, Joanna. Donal was right. It was grim last November. It was just grim. The whole country was grim. The sunshine is coming, and the summer championship is here, and spectators are here. So I'm really looking forward to it. Look, the field is immaculate. And as I said, these lads are able to hurl. Beautiful wrists, beautiful skills. So that's what I expect to see today.
To be fair to the people at Porky Creeve, even in the depth of winter, that pitch was somehow managing to hold up. It is great hearing this noise all around us and seeing the crowd start to filter in.
That's it, and the atmosphere today already is electric, and even we were here a couple of hours ago and the crowd coming in, and it's great to see the supporters back. It's going to add to the game, no doubt, today, and I think it's going to be an intriguing battle, and the matchups is just going to be brilliant all over the field.
It couldn't be lost on you, Joanne, coming down this morning, right, in terms of the difference and meeting people and even the conversation, who do you think is going to win? And look, in this part, Munster Final is a special day, right? Yeah. I know my colleagues here are not from Munster, but it's a special, special day. I remember being brought up on stories of the likes of Tipperary and Limerick and Hell's Kitchen, Doyle, Maher, Carey, Mick Mackey, all those stories. And I couldn't help looking at all the different age groups, the different jerseys mingling together, that the memories that will be made, especially for young people, that it's a really special day, and it makes such a difference that we've people here to enjoy it.
Slight little dig towards the two of you there from Donal Logue, just for change. Does he have a point? Is there a difference in quality between what we saw last night and what we're likely to see here today?
Well, I think the quality last night wasn't great. You know, I think Dublin, obviously, without the four players, struggled a little bit. But I think, look, there is this aura around the Munster final. I remember our colleague at past times, Gerald Loughnan, saying he was swinging in trees up in Turles to try and get in to see it. So it does have that aura about it. And look, we've two magnificent teams here, so it should be a great occasion.
Well, when Donal Logue was talking up the skills that we saw the last time they met in ridiculous weather, you could argue that for long periods of that, Tipperary were actually struggling in that game. Have they managed to bridge a big enough gap between then and now?
Well, that's the challenge for Liam and his team today, really. And look, I think in that opening round of the league is the league, but one aspect of that game I think Liam would have been most happy with was their work rate and their intensity that Tip brought to that league game. He's going to need it again today. And I think Tip and Limerick are going to be looking at the players on the subs bench today, because look at the weather today. It's going to be energy zapping. It's going to be high octane levels out there, and the players are going to, you know, they may tire in the last number of minutes, so they're going to need the subs bench to come on off the field, I think.
It's going to be a big shock for the players, I think, because I've seen them when they come in, just as they're walking in, they were all standing in the shade. Like, these players are told not to go out in the sunshine the last week, so they've been away from the sun. So you won't see any of them out there. Well, I hope they won't see any of them with big red faces like me and them. And it's going to be a bit of a shock to them. But look, they're so well hydrated. They're so well, you know, strength and condition. So that shouldn't be. Like, would you rather play Joanne out there today than last November? It's a very simple answer. So
I'm beginning to change my mind on that the longer I stand here.
And mention of hydration, Joanne, I think it's an important one that a lot of talk around about the water breaks and stuff like that.
Yeah.
Even if they weren't in, there'd actually be a really strong case for water breaks for the players today.
They extended the water breaks up in Ulster this evening. They're 2.5 and 3 minutes in the second half. Do we need to see leeway like that from the referees? Well, I mean, it's a no-brainer.
I'm glad to hear that, Joanne. Definitely think that common sense should prevail here. Players are just not used to it. We know they're super fit, they're super conditioned, brilliant management teams behind them, but who on this island is used to this?
is it especially a big deal when you're to wear a helmet? Let's be honest, that must make a big difference, is it?
Well, it adds to it, I think, and you know, I don't think anyone's going to refuse any player the water today, but it's going to be crucial today that players are constantly getting the water in too.
Well, what we need, Joanne, is we need the Vaseline over the eyes. When you see The Rock, when they're playing with Don Logue, The Rock O'Sullivan had more Vaseline, and it's always to stop the sweat going into the eyes. Once the sweat has gone into your eyes, that's a nuisance.
Okay, we can all agree on that, whether we have a helmet on our head or a helmet on our heads or not. Anyway, we're going to be finding out if there are any late changes with our commentator, Marty Morrissey, in just a moment. First, Damien Lawler has been speaking with Liam Sheedy and John Kiley.
John, to be competing for the Micmackie Cup Munster final, a huge tradition involved in that, first of all.
Yeah, listen, they're always very special occasions, and even today now, coming in there along the bus, you know, seeing the crowds along the side, you know, it's just fantastic to see it back again, and the sense of occasion is there. But I suppose at the end of the day, we have to concentrate on what we've got to do between the four lines and make sure we can turn up and be the best team we can be today.
Graham Mulcahy's back in the team. Has he worked fierce hard in training to impress you and get his place in that starting 15?
Yeah, he was unlucky. He picked up an ankle injury, you know, during the springtime on our recovery, and it set him back, you know, 5 or 6 weeks. But he's worked really hard in the interim, and he's a very disciplined guy. He's very experienced. So, you know, he's worked really hard to put himself where he is.
You know Tipperary inside out, but based on what you've seen this year, John, would you expect today's game to be any different tactically?
No, I think it's pretty much the same as, really, you know. Both of us will bring a lot of intensity to the game. It'll be a very hard-working game. We all have to overcome the conditions that we have today. Last year it was the monsoon. This year it's the heat wave. So, you know, I think we're still going to have a phenomenal contest today, and we just hope that we'll get our business done right and that we'll turn up and give a really strong performance, and hopefully it'll be good enough for us.
Liam, how are things since the Clare game? What specifically have you worked on since that game?
Ah, look, we're just delighted to get the win. I mean, we went back training straight away the following Tuesday night. So, look, it was great for us to get a win under our belt. It was an important win in the Munster Championship. It gave us a gateway into today, into Munster final. So, look, we've just been trying to fine-tune. There was aspects of our play we weren't overly impressed with on the day against Clare, and some aspects of our play we're very happy with. So it's about looking for that consistency, and that's what we strive to get to over the last 2 weeks in training.
Alan Flynn comes in today, Liam. He's playing very, very well at club level. And for you, what impressed you most about him in the last few weeks?
Oh, look, he got on a lot of ball around the middle of the field. You know, he really is an exceptional player, you know. And that's consistent with the form he's been shown in training. And I suppose that's the fortunate position I find myself in, Damien, is that the hands are going up in training. Alan's hand went up the highest, and he gets his chance today and fully deserving of it.
The last few times, great experience at Limerick and what they're all about, Liam. Hurling's so unpredictable, but could you have nearly one eye on this clash almost from a distance out and try and get a plan in place for that?
No, I think we always take it on a game-by-game basis. Obviously, Clare were a formidable opposition today, and we made really serious opposition today in the current Munster and All-Ireland champions. But for us, it's about our performance. We feel if we play to our potential and play the way we're able to play, we always stand a chance of winning. And today is a really big day for us in terms of where we stand in this championship. So it's a wonderful opportunity for us. We're in the Munster final. There's a cup at stake, and obviously there's a nice prize at the end of it. So, you know, whoever wins is in the last four of the championship. So that's something that we're really looking forward to.
Last question, Liam. This is a huge occasion, great tradition in the Munster final. Have your experienced leaders been kind of shown the way to the younger fellas on the panel even about what the importance of this competition and this final today means?
I think we're very fortunate because, you know, across my panel, whether it's true, you know, the guys playing minor finals and under 20 finals, there's a lot of guys, young and old, have experienced the big days and obviously winning big moments. There'll be a lot of big moments of this match, and, you know, I'd be confident that my guys have the experience to be there. So don't think experience will be a problem for us today, but we're just really looking forward to getting out on that pitch.
Let's start with the reigning champions who are seeking to win their third Munster title in a row. Just look at that Limerick defence. From 1 to 7, from goalkeeper Nicky Quaid to left-back Kyle Hayes, it looks like the perfect mix of physical presence and an abundance of hurling skill. At number 6 is the Limerick captain, Declan Hannan. The big story, of course, is the fact that Aaron Gillan doesn't start, which is a genuine surprise. Graham Mulcahy, who didn't feature that much in the league because of injury, is named to the full forward line that sees Seamus Flanagan starting his very first provincial final. William O'Donoghue and Dara O'Donovan are John Kiley's first-choice centre-field partnership, with the number 9 from Doon starting in his first Munster final. We have to credit Barry Hogan from Kildangan, who grabbed his opportunity in the league and is now first-choice keeper for his county in the championship. The positioning of Pádraig Maher at fullback remains topical with his brother in the corner. And another Maher Brendan, no relation, wearing the number 6 jersey. Midfielder Alan Flynn is the only change to the team that started against Clare, with Michael Breen now a powerful figure at centre-forward, with Jason Ford and Dan McCormack on the wings. Jamie Callanan from Drumminich leads the team from the edge of the square. And of course, Aaron Gillan is the standout absentee for the Limerick starting 15, but his presence on the bench, along with Dan Morrissey, two All-Stars in 2020, shows the depth of talent that exists in Limerick at the moment, while still giving future stars like Colin Coughlin and Carl O'Neill a place on the bench. John McGrath will be raring to go with a lot to prove if Tipperary manager Liam Sheedy gives him the call-up to the field of action. Niall O'Mara missed the Clare game due to surgery, but he makes the 26 for this Munster hurling final. The match referee is Carlos Paul-O'Dwyer, and the throw-in is about 10 minutes away.
We absolutely cannot wait. Henry Shefflin, are you surprised that those big calls, Dan Morrissey, but Aaron Gillan left on the bench?
For, you know, neutral looking in, yes it is, but obviously not. He didn't go great against Cork. I think the form and training, by all accounts, hasn't been wonderful. And John Kiely, the defending champions, he has to freshen things up. Seamus Flanagan hasn't started a Munster final before in this run, so I think he was very good the first day out, Joanne, in the National League against Tipperary. And I just think, you know, John Kiely wants to bring that bit of freshness and something
but
different.
Flanagan was in anyway.
Flanagan was in anyway, yeah, but like I suppose Graham Mulcahy is coming back as well. I think Flanagan was always going to be there, but Graham Mulcahy back in. But the only thing for me is that Gillan is such, at the apex of their forward line, he makes the runs, he makes the timings of the runs. He's so used to it, so he will be lost in that sense. But Flanagan will offer something different, and Peter Casey and Mulcahy then to pick up the break. So
we asked earlier about what Tip might do differently. Now, obviously, the Limerick turnovers is always a huge deal for them. How did Tip match them or overcome them in that aspect?
Well, look, at the last day against Clare, that was one aspect of their game I was so impressed with. You know, they scored 215 from turnovers alone. And at the heart of this was Dan McCormack, Michael Breen out around the middle third. But even the likes of Jake Morris was out around the half-forward line, making himself busy, getting the tackles in, but also the transfer of play from defence into attack. Cathal Barrett does just enough to get the flick away from Tony Kelly. And this creates Seamus Callanan's goal the last day. This is what Tip need to do today to match Limerick and their intensity levels. If someone's asking how do you define or measure a team's intensity levels, you look at their hooks, their blocks, their tackling with purpose, and obviously then their turnovers. Last year in these monsoon conditions, you know, Tip got 2-9 from turnovers again. Jamie Callanan at the heart of it, a great ball into Jake Morris, and he'll do that all day if he's given the chance. But look, this is 2 years ago in the Munster final. Limerick completely overpowered Tip in many aspects, but we see just one example of where Tip get the numbers in, they're tracking, they're swarming Will O'Donoghue and win the free. That's what Tip need to do today, but they need to do it consistently over the 70 minutes. And again, as I mentioned earlier, in the league game, the Tip got the numbers back. They swarmed it at defence. They had the half-forward line, like Jason Ford here, number 14, tracking back, crowding out Limerick, getting the hoop, getting the block in, and eventually turning over the ball. Because look, Limerick are the masters at this. In the 5 games last year in the Championship, Limerick got 76 points, 15 points per game from turnovers alone. So Tip, at the very least, have to match that today. And I think it's going to be key to their game, and it's what Liam Sheedy will be drilling into them coming into today.
Lots of different names mentioned there. Jamie Callanan is always playing a big role, but how big a year could this be for another man up in that forward line for Tip, Jason Ford?
Joanne, look, today is fascinating for loads of different aspects, the matchups, the systems, the turnovers, and they're all important, right? But ultimately, they're all secondary to wanting to see the best exponents of the game with the best skill. And for me, this is one of those players here in Jason Ford. He's coming into his prime. I was at this game at Tipperary behind him. It was over 100 metres. Might look easy. It was a tough night, cold night. He's got all of the set play aspects. He's the second highest scorer in the National League. And of course, a lot of those come from set plays. But that shouldn't be underestimated. There was a lot of talk in this game about the actual penalty. But he still had to go in and score. See, the bag was right in the very corner. He planted that perfectly. But most impressive about him is, watch this score here, right? When he'll get a sniff of goal, he's going to go for it. It was a fantastic ball from Noel McGrath, but he still had a lot of work to do and to finish it from there, but he has those wrists. I spoke before about the Tipperary players having gifted hands. Anyone plays at this, playing at this level, have gifted hands, but hurling people will know, especially what I'm on about. That previous point, he struck the ball on the run. The best players will know that you need to be able to strike the ball without breaking your stride. And that last point, even though it probably appears the most simple, was my favourite. The length of time that he kept that ball in his hand was a fraction of a second. So he's one of the players I'm really looking forward to today. The problem for Tipperary is, though, whilst he's coming into his prime, it appears as if the great under 20 teams, or the very good under 20 teams they have, it doesn't seem as if some of those are after coming through as quickly as we thought, and maybe some of his comrades who've been marquee forwards over the last couple of years are gone beyond their prime. It'll be very interesting.
And
to
I think
see
another thing was where he will set up. Will they put him out wing forward? Where are they going to get the most out of this Limerick defence? Because they have to try and identify a weakness. Is it Dermot Burns, who likes to sit back, let four drop out in front of him and try and pick off his stolen sword? Like, his wrists are just magic. So he'll score from 70 yards, no problem.
And when we talk about Limerick, we do tend to talk about the likes of Dermot Burns, the half-forward line, the half-back line in particular. But there's one man for you, and you had one yourself behind you all those years for Kilkenny, who's the unsung hero.
Yeah, we talk a lot about, you know, Limericks and all their style of play and everything like that, but this is Mr. Dependable down there. Look at that. It was a high ball last November, just so secure, and it's just his direction. Puckouts is an important part of the game, and it's just his anticipation of where he wants the ball to land, his velocity of the strike. They've 70% success rate in long puckouts over the last few years. Most teams are aiming for 50-60, and the reason for it, you see it there a second ago, he paused for a second because he knew Kyle Hayes was making the run. They were obviously going to overload that side. Again, a goal comes from this one, but it's his timing, it's his presence, it's his patience as well. Obviously, shot stopping. Look, this is a simple enough save for him, but it's on his wrong side. What I liked about that is he pushed the ball out to the side. Here's the penalty save against Patrick Horgan. Watch this, and we slow this down. He pivots his hurl, Joanne, so he turns the ball and knocks it out the wing. You think of Kasper Schmeichel a few weeks ago, where he spilled the ball in the centre. And here's this save, from an iconic save from a couple of years against Cork. I don't know if Limerick could be going for three in a row without that save, that All Ireland semi-final. And what it showcased to me was his skill. But to be fair, and I don't like saying this when Don Logan's here, the bravery of playing in goal, the bravery of him to get himself across. And I think he's been pivotal. And we talk a lot about Limerick not scoring goals, but when we look at this stat here, of the goals they've conceded, the goals to games ratio, it was 1.1 in 2018, 0.8 in 2019, and last year it was 0.6. So they don't have to score as many goals because obviously they're not conceding it. And he's a massive, massive part of this Limerick team.
We're very nearly out of time, but matchups are so huge. So who is it key to get right? Obviously, who's going to pick up Cian Lynch, you imagine, but what else? And who should, and what are the other big ones?
There's so many of those dilemmas around the field, Joanne. You could talk for ages about it. I think key for Tipperary from an attacking point of view is actually how they structure themselves defensively. They need to get a platform in around that middle third where they can supply ball to their attackers, that their attackers can work on the Limerick defenders who actually prefer attacking than defending. That's one key thing. Some of the Limerick players don't like being turned facing to their own goals. Again, the supply of ball is going to be critical there. And also, that supply
he
into the dangerous men inside is where that there. Joanne, is bigger than that. It's way bigger than that. Of course, he's going to pick up Cian Lynch. Is it going to be Brendan Maher is going to sit there? Or what's going to happen? We don't know.
Kyle Hayes is a big one. Who's going to take him up and who's going to keep him quiet?
Okay, and most me live Trochtog Oil Oscail, the Tosh Shale of All Air, serve you August Air on RT News Channel, August Air on RT Player. But for us here in Porky Cui for this Munster final, it's Michael Deignan with Marty.
Thank you very much, Joanne. Welcome to a very hot Porky Cui here in Cork with the temperatures reaching 26 degrees, a crowd of 7,000. Right now, you join us live here on the banks of the River Lee, where there's a minute silence for Darren Whelan, a 23-year-old who lost his life following an accident recently in Greece. He played at all levels in both hurling and football for the Kildymo Palaskenry Club in County Limerick. And also we think today of Brendan Oge Duffy's family in Monaghan. He captained his county's under-20s to beat Donegal on Friday evening, but lost his life in a tragic accident later that night. On behalf of everybody here in Cork and everyone on the RTE sports team, may I pass on our deepest sympathies to the Whelan and O'Duffy families.
Yeah, Marty, thank you. Well, the applause is going around for the two. I just add my condolences as well from everybody in Offaly GAA and myself personally. Tragic week for GAA, and I think it puts a lot of things in perspective. So may both the young men rest in peace.
Switched on. How long have you? Scene is set here in Parky Creeve as Limerick bid for three Munster titles in a row, 2019, 2020 and 2021. It would end an 85-year wait when Limerick last achieved this. They actually went on to win four in a row, 1933 to 1936. 11 Limerick players starting their third successive Munster final, with Daryl Dillerman and Seamus Flanagan starting in their first. Limerick playing from left to right. Tipperary won the toss, playing from in the other direction, obviously, from right to left, indeed, as Limerick start with the split the run with William O'Donoghue, getting the first touch, on fire is Keane Lynch. Bearing down, getting the first foul, as Tipperary went with an early foul. It was a bit of a soft one, to be perfectly honest, but a bit of jittery nerves at the very start.
Yeah, just a click on the heel there, but the build-up to that, the pick-up by Declan Hannan there, just back in the half-back line, first touch of the game, unbelievable pick-up onto Will O'Donoghue, great link play, that's what Limerick do so well. Michael Breen over on Kyle Hayes, two fantastic athletes, that will be some battle.
In the absence of Aaron Gillan, it is not surprising that Tom Morrissey is the one that's taken the freeze. That comes back off the post. I'd be disappointed with that. Attacking the slither was Garrod Hegarty, just slipped by him, picked up instead by Ronan Maher. Tipperary full of determination and really focused to try and stop Limerick winning this Munster Championship and indeed winning the three in a row. Ball comes out towards Kyle Haynes and Kildimo Palace-Kenry. And look at him go. Up fires the Tipperary 45, he uses the short grip. A round of applause, I think it's coming from Tipperary, but early signs what Kyle Hayes can do.
That's a huge run, Marty, but significantly Michael Breen could stay with him there. He put pressure on him and the ball went wide, and that was good work by Breen. Hayes wouldn't have expected anyone to be that close to him.
Ball won by Sean Finn, giving it over for his Declan Hannan. Up for his Keane Lynch, lovely hands again. It's Darrow Donovan, first Munster final to start, second wide of the match for the champions.
Yeah, that's three wides, or two wides, and they hit the post. Tom Morrissey on the freeze. That's a big one now, you know, with Aaron Gillan out just for the freeze, even. Tom Morrissey would have liked to tip that one over.
Puck out goes to Noel McGrath, to Ronan Maher, dropping in to Prairie. The radar just not functioning. That's their first chance of having a score, just to the wrong side of the post. Nicky Quaid dropping it down towards Garrod Hegarty that we've seen so many times in the past. Tipperary have the time and the composure to look around. Alan Flynn having a lash. And again, just a little bit uneasy start for Tipperary. They'll find their rhythm after a while. Short ball. Out for Sean Finn. Putting it into space for Keane Lynch. Dan McCormack working hard, but Lynch wins the possession. Seamus Flanagan trying to scoop it away from Tórig Mar. Coming across there is Peter Casey. Laying it off over for his Tom Morrissey. Bearing down on goal. This time he doesn't miss. The opening score of the Munster Hurling Final 2021.
And Martin, the game is only 3 minutes old, but the influence of Keane Lynch already, he's absolutely everywhere. He's flying around the pitch. Brendan Maher's on him, just dropping men back around, but Morrissey got that one and tapped it over. Good, and that's brilliant start, lively start, few wides so far.
Barry Hogan's long tuck out, there's an opportunity here. Here's a chance, here's a goal, Jake Morris. Wonderful play, Tipperary. It came from Hogan's puck out, came to Jake Morris from Nina Aerobe. Bearing down a goal, and he crashed it into the back of the net to beat Nicky Quaid, which doesn't happen that often.
Yeah, and he's standing out. He plays out deep on the wing here, and he followed in brilliantly. Great pick-up and straight through his great pace, super finish.
It's only about their third attempt in terms of scoring. They've had two previous wides to Pereira, but when they got the chance with Jake Morris, he really finished it well. And they're going for a score from way out the field, but the umpire is going to wave his arms again to the left. The umpires might be wearing their white jackets today. I don't blame them because of the sunshine, but they are very smartly dressed. White shirt and black ties, the four of them. Ball comes down to Oscar Road Hegarty. The tactic is still working, trying to get away from a Tipperary defence. Carl Barrett seems to be tripped. Barrett plays on the slither, plays on the whistle. Good play by the right corner back. Gives it over for Jason Ford, who whips it high and whips it between the posts. It's a great start for Tipperary. The jittery nerves are gone.
Yeah, and great play by Cahill Barrett. That's what he brings to the team. You know, fierce tenacious, but he's great pace coming out. Ducked through two tackles there. Picked out Jason Ford and over to Barron. Tip alternating, only playing two in the full forward line. McCallan and Morris. Dan McCormack come very deep, as is Jason Ford.
Short puck out for Richie English. He was looking to see who was making the run. There was nobody immediately available. Into the centre. This is Cahill Barrett, who gave the call. Ball given away, however, Barry Nash. William O'Donoghue had to work very hard for it. Barry Nash comes in. Fair shoulder. Going for possession. Comes back for Dan McCormack. Played well against Clare. Tries to flick it forward. Good work by Alan Flynn. It's all goal in the 26 degrees heat. Comes back for Sean Finn. Gives it on for Garrod Hegarty. Garrod Hegarty goes for distance down towards Big Seamus. Big Seamus is there, that's Flanagan. Bringing it back out to the 13. He's going to have a goal from there. It's a very acute angle. It is a thing of beauty. Big in heart, big in physique, but big in terms of hurling talent and skill.
Yeah, super ball there by Garrett Hegarty. Was it a free in the way in? And but Flanagan moved back outside over the bar. What a frantic start to the game. A few wides so far, but a brilliant start. And the condition and the fitness of these players, unbelievable.
Cahill Barrett goes long, very long, dropping it in towards Big Shamie Callan. Did anybody get a touch? The umpire says no. Tuck out for Nicky Quaid. Again, Barry Nash goes short, makes himself available. South Liberty's man. And he goes for the return pass as well. Looking around. Nobody immediately available. Goes down towards Big Seamus Flanagan. Battling with Paddy Marr. Calling for it outside is Ronan Marr. Younger brother of the fullback. Into the centre. Good play by Tipperary. Good composure. Good use of the hand pass. And going long then when it really matters. Opportunity. There's an overlap. There's a chance. Here's for Jason Ford, and that's over the bar. There might be 7,000 people here, but even up here I could hear Jason Ford.
Yeah, look, the composure of the Tipperary backs on the ball there. Every one of them are great hurlers. Two or three involved there. Great ball inside. Unselfish play by Jake Morris, and Ford with his second from play.
Garrod Hegarty and Keane Lynch both going for the same ball. Garrod trying to slip one through first. Keane Lynch doesn't quite work out. And Tipperary go for distance and go for a score from way out the field. Oh my gosh, that is fantastic play. Wonderful, wonderful point from way out the field by Dan McCormack from Borussia.
And that's what he does so well, Marty. He's so tenacious in the tackle. He's out there. His work rate, unbelievable. Just broken there. Garrett Hegarty just a little bit too fancy. Dan McCormack read it. If you look at Dan McCormack now, he's down on Keane Lynch for the puck outs and leaving Brendan Maher free. So they're playing with five forwards and McCormack working all over the field.
Puck out again is aimed at Keane Lynch. Magnificent catch again. Good hand. Seamus Flanagan. The hand pass back is not great, but Lynch picks it up in his stride. Survives the challenge, then Taz a go, and that's over the bar, I think. It's the ref. Yes, the umpire's eventually getting there, confirming that it is Keane Lynch's first score.
Yeah, and he was fouled twice. The ref had the hand up for the advantage, but look at this for a catch. Dan McCormack back on him, but Lynch absolutely brilliant so far. And what a start to this game. 8 minutes in, it's full of life, full of drive and determination.
Attacking the ball from the back is Sean Fenn from Brough, three times an All-Star. Going long as Limerick on a two-man full forward line. Great ball. Chance for Peter Casey. He decides not to test out Barry Hogan and take the point instead. Peter Casey from the Piershik getting his first point.
Yeah, and Garrett Hegarty getting more influential. Lovely ball into Peter Casey. I think he should have taken on his man, headed for the goals. You know, when you get that chance in the Munster final, go for it. But he tapped it over the bar.
4 points for Limerick. One goal and three for Tipperary, and they're all from play. No frees so far. And again, three number players in that half back line, all available. Great block down. It's Tipperary with great tenacity and determination. Are really up for this Munster final. Alan Flynn from Caledangan is fouled. The referee going to give a free to Tipperary.
Look at Dan McCormack again here. Full length dive in, block down. Brilliant. Hegarty standing to hit it. I actually think he took a slap when he was on the ground as well there, but he's back on his feet now. He certainly took a slap and he was down there, and Alan Flynn fouled for the free.
Just getting some medical attention. Dr. Brendan Murphy and Paddy O'Brien all in there. As, Jason Ford scored a goal and 8 points against Clare. A penalty, three frees and one from the sideline. Yes, this is dropped in. And that's the first score from a face ball that we've had in this Munster final. That comes almost after 10 minutes. Nicky Craig's puck out is aimed at Keane Lynch, picked up by Jason Ford again. Second time round. Between the 45 and 65, almost on the 65. And he hits this from way out, just spontaneously, in one sweeping movement. Beautiful.
Yeah, and Jason Ford is at centre forward. John O'Dwyer is on one wing, Michael Breen on the other. And Jason Ford is drifting off Declan Hannan. Hannan likes to sit back and he's causing havoc. He's three from play and he's picking up everything himself, and Dan McCormack working tirelessly.
Barry Nash and Sean Finn finding Tom Morrissey. Barry Nash gives it long. Toddy Maher, great bit of stuff from the guard, a beast in Limerick. And he's looking for the return pass. He'll be up for this clash with Seamus Flanagan, although Flanagan got the first point. And there was a 50-50 ball between them, but good work by the Perlis Arsley's man. Wonderful block down again. Tipperary, composed under pressure. Paddy Maher looks around to see anybody down the right wing, decides to change the direction. Good play, making a little bit of space. Great work by Jamie Callanan. John O'Dwyer, however, can't capitalise on it. He was under pressure. That's the fifth wide of the match for Tipperary. Have scored a goal in five. Straight down the middle, Gerard Hegarty. For the first time, he has the composure, the space, and he avails of all of those qualities to put that over the bar for his first point.
Yeah, it's his first score, but he has been influential. He had time there, people drifted off him, and he just turned around and took a simple point.
Five of the six Limerick forwards have now scored. John O'Dwyer going for that point again. He knows it himself. The body language says it all.
Yeah, and it's taking the Limerick defenders a while to figure out the movement of the Tipperary forwards. They're absolutely moving all over the place. Jake Morris switching with bubbles again. They're playing two in the full forward line, then three. Dan McCormack is in and out. And again, that bubbles will be disappointing. That's an easy chance for someone of his calibre.
Tom Morrissey giving it back. Farrah's Dermot Burns. Diagonal ball over towards Seamus Flanagan. This time he gets ahead of Paddy Maher. Turns the engine around and goes in the opposite direction, and hits it sweetly between the posts. Scored a goal and a point against Tipperary in the championship in that awful day last year. He's already making a mark, the big full forward.
A brilliant touch there and a brilliant score and a great ball by Dermot Burns. Fantastic on the diagonal. Here's it going long again.
Barry Hogan dropping it in around the square. Back there. Making sure that everything was all right from a Limerick perspective was Darragh Donovan. Coming back, that was Declan Hannan. That was Darragh Donovan further out. And the ball comes out to the Tipperary man. And he puts that between the posts and over the bar. And it's Jason Ford with his fifth point of the game.
Yeah, and you can't blame Declan Hannan for that one. It was a bad ball out by Dermot Burns, too hard at Darragh Donovan's feet. But that's four from play in the first 13 minutes. And I think Declan Hannan is in trouble, on big trouble on Jason Ford.
Sideline ball. Going to Limerick. John Kiley, manager of this Limerick side for the fifth year in a row. Nice ball in towards William O'Donoghue. Paulie Maher comes out to love little stick work by the Thurles man. Great play by the fullback. Little flick up by Ronan Maher. Good play over for Barry Heffernan. Excellent play, Tipperary. Away goes Seamus Kennedy from the St. Mary's Club. Good footballer as well. Fine hurler, but just wrong side again with the toss. Tipperary now have registered 7 points.
Yeah, and they're really keeping Limerick in it. That should have been flicked on to Noel McGrath. That was a reckless shot there from Seamus Kennedy.
Tom Morrissey. Straight from Nicky Quaid's puck out. Sends this superbly between the posts. Straight, simple, long puck out, long ball. Morrissey out by the wing. He has the ability to put it between the posts.
Yeah, and the Limerick half forward line already hugely influential. Hegarty, Morrissey, Lynch, all playing super.
Long puck out from Barry Hogan. Declan Hannan comes across. Looks again. Shows the composure. Two against one here. Tipperary man is Barry Heffernan. Opportunity for Jason Ford. Unmarked momentarily. And the umpire is bending his back again for another white flag. Jason Ford is on fire and Limerick have to do something about it.
To do, and but look again, Mark, the composure of the Tipperary backs, they're all such great hurlers. Brilliant catch by Heffernan, but Ford is just moving left and right, he's causing havoc, and you know, they need to put somebody on him. None of the rest of the Tip forwards making much of an impact, but he is absolutely going to town.
It looks like that William O'Donoghue is taking up the responsibility of marking Jason Ford at the moment there in the middle of the field, but it's hard to mark him because he's everywhere.
Well, Lehman O'Shea's fingerprints all over this performance. We've seen it before from the Tip forwards, their movement fantastic.
Kyle Hayes. Beating a track down the wing. Lovely stick work. Heading towards the 20. Referee Paul Dwyer says it's a free out. There was just a little notion that Kyle was heading towards the ground, but not too sure whether that's the right decision.
But there's Dan McCormick. You can see him well wrapped around him, down over him. I don't know. You know, that's a free. Brilliant piece of skill. Twice off the ground. Dan McCormick in over his back. That's a free in.
Ball back in towards the Tipperary full forward line. Love little stick work again. Difficult enough angle there. Slices off the boss of the hurling from Noel McGrath. Ball is wide.
Yeah, if you look inside there, Shane McCallan had backed off of Sean Finn is the nearest one to him there. He was looking for the pass. He backed away. If Noel saw him, he looked up, but he chose to tap it over and he missed it.
Kyle Hayes again. Darragh Donovan. Down towards Seamus Flanagan. Ronan Maher gone back to collect. Long ball again. Once they get the ball around the half back line, they're going long. 9 times out of 10, Tipperary. Ball down towards the full forward line, particularly Graham Mulcahy. No foul committed. Puck out for Barry Hogan.
Yeah, Limerick going very direct into the full forward line. They usually play it through the half forward line, but they hit a lot of ball in there. Seamus Flanagan to score two, but both Peter Casey and Graham Mulcahy very quiet so far. Barry Heffernan's having a fantastic season. Cahill Barrett so tight as well. So, you know, Aaron Gillan will be talking about him, I'm sure, before half time or around that time.
Barry Nash under the breaking ball, picked up by John O'Dwyer, given for Shamie Calman. He runs away. He knows he has scored. Excellent point by the Tipperary captain.
And he's so cool in those positions. Just such confidence in his own ability. Here's the water break. What a start. Apart from the wides, it's been an absolutely savage, entertaining game.
It's hard to believe that it's 26 degrees. Five of the Tipperary, of the Limerick forwards have scored, and four of the Tipperary forwards have scored. Let's go down to the sideline for up close and personal to our reporter this afternoon, Damien Lawler. Your view of the match so far, Damien?
Well, I'm just watching both sidelines here, Marty. It's pretty thunderous on the sideline as well. Jason Ford is obviously having a great quarter, and John Kiley has just come in to ask his players to push up hard on Jason Ford. Tipperary, well, they're retreating off the Limerick puck out. They've done that all this year, but the big difference is they're playing two in their full forward line, and every other Tipperary player has been encouraged and asked to press Limerick from there on in. They're also looking to spread the play across the pitch and to use every bit of space is there. Limerick fielders, a bit of change to be got in the right side of their attack as well, so they're trying to exploit a bit of space up there. So far, one other thing to watch as well, Keen Lynch has looked to pick up a small bit of a knock. Limerick have sent in both a doctor and a physio to keep an eye on him, so it's just hopefully he'll be able to continue freely, but certainly the mood is very thunderous on the sideline as well as the pitch, Marty.
Indeed, thank you very much, Damien. I was just watching the Limerick bench, but let's have a look at the goal again from the Tipperary perspective, Michael.
Yeah, you just watch Jake Morris. He's just coming in there, running in, and look, just the gap opened up in front of him, but he's very good at that. He's great pace. He starts outside sometimes and comes in. We saw Larry Corbett doing that for a long time. And you just have to say, Marty, you know, 17 minutes in, Tip really should be 6 or 7 points up. They've had 8 wides in that first 17 minutes to Limerick's 3. Some of them, by their standard, John O'Dwyer had a couple, Noel McGrath, a long-range shot there from Seamus Kennedy. The discipline as well on the Tipperary side, very, very good. They've only conceded that first 3, which was the scored. So they're making Limerick work really, really hard for their scores. So you'd have to say Tipperary tactically very, very sharp. And, you know, I mentioned to you just before the game off air that I thought the Tip bench looked that bit stronger than Limerick's. So, look, it's all to play for. You'll find great champions. They'll come to grips with this. But Jason Ford is the man. 5 points from play in the first 17 minutes of the Munster final. Phenomenal.
Two all-stars waiting to be called in. That's Aaron Galland, number 21, and Dan Morrissey, number 26. And so far, this is the man that's very much on fire. 6 points. Five of them, actually, from play. Just one from a free. It's interesting as well. I know, Michael, you mentioned about the influence of Eamon O'Shea. And I know Liam Sheedy took over the pep talk at the water break, but initially it was Eamon O'Shea. Tactically, very successful management in the past, of course, himself and Liam. Back to the action as Paulie Maher gets a little touch ahead of Seamus Flanagan, and that's going to be a sideline ball for Limerick. Seamus Flanagan doesn't normally take the sideline cuts, going to do it this time himself. Quick ball in towards Keane Lynch. Under a little bit of pressure. Dan McCormack, Tipperary battling hard, and they win that 50-50 ball. Declan Hannan just taking his eye off it, but he has the composure and experience to make the space for himself. Down for Seamus Flanagan, and that is looking straight and through, but wide of the target. That is Limerick's fourth wide of the match. Pulsating, entertaining contest here in Parkycreek. Long tuck out from Barry Hogan. Opportunity again, going for the goal! And what a goal! Incredible finish! What a finish by John O'Dwyer! Oh my word, it is work coming to Parkycreek.
And Marty, the same thing again, route one, looking for the break, and in they came after. What a finish! And the confidence, he missed a couple of chances. Look at that for a finish, unsavable. And Tipperary going along with the puckouts, doing really, really well. It's a tactic, obviously, that developed, and men coming in from behind. And look, I think Tipperary deserved that lead. They're playing all the hurling at the minute.
No doubt that the champions are struggling here now, conceding 2 goals, which doesn't normally happen. Nicky Quaid beaten by 2 raspers. And where the ball landed, there's going to be a fray. Referee Todd Dwyer had no doubt. Cathal Barrett is saying that he was innocent. He was, actually. It was from where the ball landed. That's hasn't quite understood what happened.
Yeah, well, look, there was a bit of talk during the week. Liam Sheedy was making the point that Cathal Barrett, referee, different than other cornerbacks. He was obviously trying to get inside Todd Dwyer's head. The two of them were coming out for the ball there, and I think Barrett did seem to have a hold of Peter Casey. in any event, the free is awarded, and Tom Morrissey hit the post with a similar one at the start of the game, so he'd be looking just to tap this one out.
He's 25 years of age since the month of May. Under 21 All-Ireland medalist in 2015 and 17 when he was captain. That's Tom Morrissey. Limerick needed a score. It's his third of the match. But they just needed to settle because they're simply not used to conceding goals. But what spectacular, brilliant goals by Tipperary. First by Jake Morris after 3 minutes, and then John O'Dwyer just moments ago. Puck out from Barry Hogan. Going long with most of these puck outs. Gathered superbly. And the finish is just a little bit off. Good effort again by John O'Dwyer. That's his third time trying from there. He'll get it eventually.
I was going to say, Marty, he could have won three on the board. Here's Hayes now in space.
Kyle Hayes straight from the puck out. That's a free, no question. And a chance for Limerick again to get a little bit closer to their neighbours and opponents. It's Kyle Hayes who's fouled here. No question whatsoever by Shane McCann.
But you'd have to say, Marty, John O'Dwyer on Dermot Burns, creating loads, scored the goal, could have in a couple of times. Jake Morris, they're moving. You know, he has Barry Nash in all sorts of trouble. Declan Hannan in trouble. Kyle Hayes been kept relatively quiet by Michael Breen, and you can see they're targeting him every time he gets the ball. So Tipperary tactically working, and their work rate savage as well all over the field.
A little bit of concern about John O'Dwyer. Under 21 All-Ireland medalist himself in 2010, John Kiley grabs the space and opportunity to talk to his fellow selectors. A little bit of concern on Shannon Siders. Ball comes back off the post. Seamus Flanagan chasing after it again. Paddy Maher staying with him. Flanagan has to recycle it, bring it back outside. Good work here as Limerick try and create an opportunity for a point that is very well taken. Good score, Dermot Burns.
Yeah, he'd be delighted that he hit the post. Second free to hit the post, but a lovely ball back out by Flanagan and the pace there of Burns and power and angled it over the bar.
Long puck out again from Barry Hogan. Clearly, it's the strategy. Put pressure on the Limerick half-backs rather than going short. William O'Donoghue. Just the hands this time of Peter Casey slipped through his fingers. Tipperary are there in numbers. One of them is Brendan Maher from Borisoleil getting it into the centre. Coming across, getting a touch is big Michael Breen from Ballinan, laying it off. It's Tipperary again, go for a long-range point, and this one is over the bar. It took a moment, but Seamus Kennedy will take the credit for a fine effort from way out the field.
Yeah, super work by Michael Breen there, showed his pace, just knocked it in, and then had the composure to pick out Kennedy, and he was dead right. He was only 50 yards out, he turned back, and great score.
Limerick have the possession. Momentarily. Great tenacity by Tipperary again. Sweet ball from Ronan Maher. Good hands. Dead straight in front of the post. And that will raise another white flag. And once again, it's John Bubbles O'Dwyer.
And Marty, he's been criticised maybe before for maybe his fitness levels. He's absolutely flying out there. Right? He's putting on an exhibition. And Dermot Burns, one of the great wing backs, and he's causing them all sorts of trouble. And the Tipperary tactics at the back are brilliant. Everybody pushing up tight. Brendan Maher dropping in behind. Dan McCormick walking back there with them. And it's working brilliant at the minute for them.
Hard working Graham Mulcahy is in there. Manages to squeeze it first. Keane Lynch. He tries to give it back to Mulcahy. But look at the Tipperary defence. They're swarming all over them, chasing everything, coming away with it, surviving the challenge, giving it just a little bit forward. Good work by Limerick, by Peter Casey in particular. But Tipperary have it once more, looking around. I love the way they have the composure to have that vision, putting it into the corners as Tipperary go for really difficult angles, but great defending this time by Limerick. Referee blows the whistle, feeds to the Limerick band, which is very quickly taken. Comes down for William O'Donoghue. Williams sending it long over towards Seamus Flanagan. Paddy now is underneath it, showing what a wonderful talent he is. And they doubted his fullback ability. My word. Great ball won. Over for his Declan Hannah. I'll say it again, it's 26 degrees in Cork. And look at the speed and sheer determination of these two great hurling teams as the ball is sent in off the stick of this man, Tom Morrissey, who's getting his fourth point in the Munster final.
Yeah, and he's third from play, and Limerick haven't been doing enough of that. That's what they do so well. Their half-back line break the tackle, they pick their half-forward line moving, and they put it over. They have five from play from the half-forward line, but they're going long and they're not getting anywhere. Cathal Barrett, Toddy Maher and Barry Heffernan doing very, very well in the full back line, and that long ball not working.
Declan Hannan, Dickie and Lynch, takes on the shoulder, steps away from the challenge. One, two, three, over for Garrod Hegarty. Hurler of the year in the past, hurler of the year last year, but the effort at the very end was disappointing. It had the potential for so much more.
Yeah, I'm surprised he didn't take it on. There was a couple of heavy hits on Cian Lynch, and he gave a lovely weighted pass over the top, and Hegarty just trying to tap it over the bar. It probably caught in two minds. He probably was thinking of heading on for the goals, and in hindsight, it's an easy thing to do from up here. He probably should have.
Short puck out this time for his running mark. Gives that ball again to us, big Shane McCallan, knocked away by Richie English. Graham Mulcahy comes in search of the slither. Up goes big Seamus Flanagan. Ball breaks towards Toddy Maher. Send it down towards Jason Ford. Dermot Burns, great anticipation, read the situation well. Giving it short for his Declan Hannan. Nice stick work. Giving it back again for his Dara Donovan. Floating one in. Up comes Seamus Flanagan. Doesn't connect. No free, no foul. Referee is correct. Barry Hogan sends it over to the wing. But there's a man available waiting. That happens to be Noel McGrath. Gives a diagonal ball, that's the plan. Barry Nash intercepts. Looking around for the support. It's there's plenty. One of them happens to be Richie English. Gives the ball first, the Dune man, Darrow Donovan, to his midfield partner, William O'Donoghue. Thought about giving it back again. Look at the way Tipperary are tackling, chasing, Harrison. Is there a score at the end of it all? I would say there is. And Jason Ford is now on 7 points. Six of them from play, only one from a free.
Yeah, to me that's the most important score of the game so far. A huge passage of play in that, he drained and stuff, and Tipperary come up with the turnover, and Jason Ford over the bar. Here's Cian Lynch now, is this one about to creep? That's wide as well.
Rather unusual for him to kind of feel the pressure, feel the heat, and go for a score when he had plenty of time to play it around. And Liam Sheedy certainly has orchestrated, from a strategic point of view, a very impressive performance. Can they maintain it right now? You have to look at them and say yes. Ball breaks off Rich English, and as a result, that is an easy enough point. It's kind of the first easy point that we've seen the Tipperary have gotten. That's off Jake Morris, who, like John O'Dwyer, has now scored a goal and a point.
Yeah, and I don't know if the sun is a factor out there, because that's very unusual. Rich English missed that ball completely. And look at Tip attacking the ball again. Limerick waiting for it. It's not working.
Dan McCormack. To John O'Dwyer. Is it sneaking inside the post? It's an absolute beauty. McCormack bubbles to this fantastic score in the glorious sunshine in Cork.
And the way he was drifting back there on his back foot and just had the skill to slice it in, he actually faded that in from left to right. And Dan McCormack again. Look, he's picking up Cian Lynch there. It's working very well. Lynch has had his moments, but McCormack has got the grips of him.
Ball breaks down for us. Tom Morrissey, and that one is well wide, but it possibly reflects the pressure that Limerick find themselves under at the moment.
100% ready. Three Tipperary men in on him there on the break, and that's it. The work rate is phenomenal, and the condition of the Tip players.
Here's an interesting statistic for you. Tipperary have scored 2 goals and 13 points, 2 goals and 12 from play. That's pretty impressive.
That's seriously impressive.
Building from the back this time. Little trip to Noel McGrath. Referee says play on. He was waving the advantage. But the advantage wasn't accruing, so it's a free for Tipperary.
Yeah, I think Jason Ford will take his time coming out to this one. Give everybody a little breather.
Time for Limerick to consult. And Paul Kinnerk was there in picture a moment ago with John Kiley. But there's no doubt about it. We've seen Limerick over the last number of years. I don't think I've ever seen them in as much trouble in the first half. No. In the last 2 or 3 years.
Well, Marty, I'd say they're not playing that bad. It's just a brilliant performance by Tipperary. It's absolutely one of, you know, they've done this over the last number of years. They've done it under Liam Sheedy, Eamon O'Shea on a number of occasions, but this is a fantastic team performance. Every single one of the Tipperary players are playing out of their skin.
Jason Ford, championship debutant against Kilkenny back in 2013. Spent his little bit of time on the sub, gaining experience, but now he's a top-class player. and he's now in this Munster final on 8 points. 6 from play, 2 from frees.
And his confidence, Martin, he just doesn't look like he's going to miss anything. He went out to that, it's, I don't know, on the diagonal, 95 yards out, and he put it 30 yards over the bar. It's just a phenomenal strike, and he's having one of those days that you dream of.
Richie English seems to have a bit of a problem here. His head is nodding there, that doesn't seem good. He was pulled back under 21 All-Ireland medalist back in 2015. Aaron Gillan is going to be introduced as Limerick make the changes, but he's definitely still coming on. And Graham Mulcahy is the player that's going to make way for him.
And I think it's kind of ironic. I don't think I've ever seen Limerick play as much ball into the full forward line.
Well, there's a welcome for Aaron Gillan from Barry Heffernan, basically saying hello, this is the Munster final. And
yeah, we'd expect that.
We're ready for you.
We'd expect that, but I'm just saying, I never saw, you know, the amount of ball that's gone in there, and Gillan would thrive on that with the great hand that he has. And here's Rich English gone. I'm hoping it's not anything to do with his bad knee injury that he had with the bad cruciate. But he's certainly gone. And Dan Morrissey, what a sub to have. And two All-Stars in 30 seconds.
Dan Morrissey in a full-back, Aaron Gillan into the full-forward line. And that comes after 31 minutes, which is a clear indication that the Limerick management also feel that changes are necessary. Here comes a nice combination, possible score, but Keane Lynch unselfishly gave it towards Seamus Flanagan. To vary there in numbers, good defending. As Limerick try and put the pressure on here, William O'Donoghue's in there, and but Tipperary come away with it. Still shoulder to shoulder, ends up with Jake Morris just outside his own 45-meter line, puts it into the space. It's an easy ball for the substitute Dan Morrissey to gather. In Farris, Declan Hannan. Farris the other Morrissey from Aha. Tom Morrissey dropping this in. Barry Hogan had to keep his eye on it. But the ball is in the net. But the referee has blown his whistle for Seamus Flanagan being inside the small rectangle. He blew his whistle immediately. Let's look and see exactly what happened.
It's inconclusive there. I don't know, was he inside? He's on the move in, but where he started, I'm not 100% sure. He was moving in. I don't. The initial reaction was he wasn't inside. He was coming in after the ball. Big call.
Big call by the referee, and he blew it immediately. But meanwhile, it's back to Barry Nash. Back to Nash again from Tom Morrissey. Now Limerick need this man, Aaron Gillan. Will he try for a goal from there? He's satisfied to take his point. And already, he's made an impact.
And I think some of that is psychological. You're Barry Heffernan. You're now marking Aaron Gillan. He didn't attack that ball maybe the way he's been attacking the others. He was afraid of getting slipped. And that's what Gillan can do. It's a big Tipperary lead, but we've seen in hurling before. 9 points can turn around very, very quickly.
First score for Limerick in 8 minutes as the road Hegarty comes in that 50-50 ball, picked up by Keane Lynch. Laying it into the corner towards Peter Casey. Peter Casey having to work hard for it. Ball is back. There's a foul clearly on the Limerick man as well by Noel McGrath. Referee says nothing. Didn't indicate. Back to Noel McGrath. Can't put him out over the sideline. Can't get near him. Ball into the centre towards Dan McCormack. Goes for distance again. The long ball. Just getting a little touch was Dan Morrissey. And that is a 65 for Tipperary.
Yeah, well, I think there was definitely a foul in Limerick. I think the ball was picked off the ground as well. I think Limerick aggrieved with that. And this could be a 2-point swing, or a possible 2-point swing, because Limerick were on the attack.
So on two occasions, as I said, in that sequence of play, Limerick deserved a foul.
Correct.
Interesting enough as well that Cathal Barrett has taken up responsibility in marking Aaron Gillan. So there's a switch there between himself and Barry Heffernan. Meanwhile, it's Jason Ford. Man on fire. 8 points so far in this Munster final to increase the Premier County's lead. Hits it well with conviction, confidence, and accuracy.
Straight
he's
down
on nine.
Straight down the tunnel, and that's straight behind in the middle of the goals, and I had him marked down before he even took it. He's just striking the ball so beautiful.
Ball is plucked out quickly. And Nicky Quaid. Great work by Limerick to regain the possession. Over his shoulder. He's a bit optimistic, but the umpire has no doubts. The Rod Hegarty disappointed, pleading with the referee. But I don't think anybody really thought it was going over the bar in Páirc Uí Chaoimh.
And it was 2 minutes. It was the wrong option, Marty. Seamus Flanagan was on his own, and he saw him. He just chose to ignore him to put it over the bar himself, and that's what happens when you're rattled. You know, the lack of oxygen out there, the heat. They're 9 points down, 10 points down. So, wrong call again.
Barry Nash, bursting forward, looking for a little bit of help and support. And the referee giving the free for the infringement just moments earlier. As we're now into injury time, 2 minutes to be added on. And Tipperary leading 2:15 to 11 points. In a very impressive performance by the challengers from the Premier County. Effort from the Limerick 45 is a good one. And the white flag will be raised thanks to Dermot Burns' sprint.
A great strike. It's almost routine now for these lads, but that's, you know, your own 45 and flew over the bar. Great score.
And once upon a time we were amazed when those things happened, but it's normal service now. Barry Hogan again. Going for that long, long puck out, putting Limerick under pressure right from the off. Ball breaks down for Darrell Dunover. Can Limerick get another score before the break? Ball was half blocked. Noel McGrath, quick hands, a little bit too quick. Not even John O'Dwyer could reach that one. Liam Sheedy, managing this Tipperary team and very pleased. In contrast, John Collier, I think, will be happy to get his team into the dressing room to have a retake. Barry Nash going to take the sideline cuts. It's a good one into the centre, but again, Tipperary are attacking right for the front. There's a touch on there by Seamus Flanagan. There was a chap down, and Toddy Maher is not a man that goes down easily. He's getting a pat in the back and saying well done, because it was a 50-50 ball. This was the incident. Great play by Toddy Maher. He's having a great old tussle with Seamus Flanagan, who I know has scored twice, but there's at least 4 or 5 balls that Toddy Maher has won handsomely.
Toddy Maher has been brilliant. I think that was a free was given way after Toddy Maher. The hurl came in. It was a complete accident. And look, maybe he'd give him a little flick, but I think that was the experience of Toddy Maher showing there. He won that free.
Jason Ford is now heading towards double figures. This could be his 10th point of the match as we approach halftime. Never in any doubt. It's been an awesome performance by Jason Ford. A brilliant performance by Tipperary. And the Tipperary supporters, who love their hurling, give their team a warm round of applause. We've had 2 spectacular goals by Jake Morris in the 3rd minute, John Bubbles O'Dwyer in the 19th. Liam Sheedy, look at him, look at the intensity. It's as if he's hitting every ball, picking up every slither. He's giving his team a round of applause. That's management, that's intensity, that's pressure. And that is a man that is also on fire. Liam Sheedy and Tipperary. John Kiley will have to rethink his strategy with his management team for the second half. We're having a thriller on the banks of the River Lane. It's Limerick, 12 points. Tipperary, 2 goals and 16 at halftime.
In last year's championship meeting between these sides in Cork, there were 9 points in at half-time. This time it's 10, and this time it's Tip who are on top. Well, Henry Shefflin insists that he, had he been asked, was going to Tip to win today. What happened out there?
Well, I think what we saw from Tip was they started like we expected. They just came right out of the tracks. You know, they were seriously motivated. They brought a lot of energy to do it. And just the wrist, Joanne. Everything they were striking was straight to hand. It was sticking, and just some of the scores were sublime. So, and Limerick just on the other side look a bit lethargic. I think Tip got their matchups
very right, and as I said, it just set the tempo for what was coming, and Jake Morris's goal then at the early stage was a great fillip for them.
When they smelled blood, they just went for the jugular, didn't they? And they got those two goals, which could prove to be so important.
Look, obviously, there was a fierce similarity about both goals. Seamus Callanan's movement from inside, creating the space, first of all for Morris, right, to finish, was a fantastic finish. But what, both goals were nearly carbon copy of each other. Callanan leaves the square, the defenders are tracked towards him. There's no one on the Limerick side is being defensive or paranoid enough, as you need to be as a defender at times, to say, I'm going to cover off that space, and it allows Morris to get through. Don't underestimate the finish. It was still a good finish. But again, like I said, very, very similar. Key is here that Callanan leaves, but as important is that his man is tracking him, and it leaves space for Bubbles. In terms of difficulty of finishes, this one was some finish. He still had way more work than Morris had once he got possession of the ball.
And I think a great thing here, Joanne, is that they're going over that Limerick strong half back line. They're getting in behind him, and then Bubbles was coming onto it. But look, this finish was just immaculate, just right behind into the top corner. It was just brilliant to see.
The one thing you flagged, and many people flagged before, was that Tip had to get on top of these turnovers as well. Are they the leading side from that point of view?
Without a doubt, and Tip have scored 6 points in comparison to Limerick in that first half with turnovers. And the likes of Dan McCormack, you know, he's getting the overhead, you know, he's winning the battle between himself and Keane Lynch. But Paddy Maher at full back, there was probably question marks maybe coming into the game. Would he be able to handle the likes of Flanagan in on the edge of the square? But time and time again, they're swarming in around the likes of Kyle Hayes, Hegarty, and turning over the ball, winning frees. And I think that's one of the main reasons why Tip are on top, because they're not giving Limerick the space, they're disrupting their play, and Limerick are probably getting a little bit frustrated and hitting some uncharacteristic wides. Seamus Kennedy, Brendan Maher, leaders all over the field, and defensively Tip will be really, really strong. But key to it is that they have got the matchups right, and a couple of years ago in the Munster final they were exposed on some of the areas, and I think Liam Sheedy is getting it right so far.
Donal Oak said, don't forget to say that he's the one who flagged Jason Ford would have a big impact in this game.
Well, he's only got 10 points, to be honest with you, but he's been brilliant. But for interesting, for watching here behind, it's kind of a little triangle like they do in the soccer, to be honest with you. Here's Barrett just busting out the ball. He was brilliant for the first 20 minutes. But he just finds himself in pockets of space, right? So how is that for the viewers? What's happening is that himself, Bubbles O'Dwyer and Noel McGrath are kind of interplay between midfield, wing forward, corner forward. So they just find themselves, and Limerick are very much confused, I think. They don't know whether to go or come. And look, his balance and his striking is just immaculate, you know.
But it's the movement as well. They're getting themselves in the correct position, and they're such intelligent hurlers that they're well comfortable in scoring from distance as well.
Joanne, I can't emphasise this enough. When you asked me the question beforehand about the matchups, why I didn't give you the direct answer is it's more than that. Brendan Maher is a perfect example. In the first half, he's been marking Morrissey, he's been marking Hegarty. But we're drawn to the movement and the scoring. But the movement and the scoring is nothing without having your structure in place behind that, where the players can get into a situation and give quality ball. And Tipperary have dominated that. And key to it is Ronan Maher. If you watch him off the ball, everybody knows Limerick like to tack down that side. Maher is covering off that wing fully. Even Limerick, there's a game of cat and mouse going on. They've put Tom Morrissey on him, they've put Garrod Hegarty on him to try and drag him into the play and allow the space behind. Now, what's very interesting is we know Gillan, that's his territory. Yeah. That's his area that he wants to get. So that's the game that's going on, and why it's more a chain of events rather than being binary.
And even though there are 10 points in it at halftime, we are certain we're going to have a big, big second half. It's coming up shortly. Strong first half performance from Tipperary has them 216 to 12 points up at half time against the All-Ireland champions and defending Munster champions Limerick. But is there a possibility that perhaps there should have been a goal allowed for Limerick there?
I don't think so, Joanne, to be honest. Dan Morrissey drops one short, Tom Morrissey drops one short, Brian Hogan just spills it, and we'll just see on the replay though. To be fair, Seamus Flanagan was in the square before the ball arrived. And actually on the third replay, you'll watch here, his hand actually catches him on the face guard, so just knocks the ball out of his hand. So no, definitely free out.
We saw a couple of frees missed there by Limerick in the first half. You mentioned the difference that Gillan could have coming on. Does it look now like a mistake in hindsight for Aaron Gillan not to have started that game?
Well, it was a big decision and a big factor. And I suppose, look at Jason Ford on the other hand. He hasn't missed any frees. But Galan, you know, is in corner forward. Barrett's in on top of him. So it's going to be a really key battle in this game.
Do you see Limerick coming back into this? Don't know.
I don't see that the gap being still the same at the end of this game. I wouldn't be surprised if Limerick pushed this all of the way to the wire.
Henry?
No, Tip will win it. 216. Another 10 points, they're going to get 226. So they'll be fine.
Okay, there you go. There are big words from Henry Shefflin. Here come the team that are going for three Munster titles in a row, the All-Ireland champions Limerick, as we head back to Michael and Marty.
Thank you very much, Joanne. Doesn't seem to be any changes. Aaron Galland there and Seamus Flanagan joining Nicky Quaid, last year's All-Star goalkeeper. Of course, his dad, his late dad, Tommy, was All-Star hurling goalkeeper in 1992. But meanwhile, back now, it's going to be interesting to see what Limerick can do in this second half. As Todd Dwyer from Carlow, refereed the previous Munster final in 2019, restarts the match as the ball is dropped in. Good understanding between goalkeeper and defender means Barry Hogan can come away with it without any great degree of pressure. Can they maintain the intensity and the speed that we saw in the first half? Has gone across to gather this is Declan Hannan, giving it a little flick as they try to build from the back. Pass to Barry Nash was poor, to say the least. But well recovered. Kyle Hicks made a few good penetrating runs in the first half, but his main job was defending in the second period of the first half, if you know what I mean. But the ball comes down to Aaron Galland. His battle is, our pundits were saying with Joanne, is going to be an interesting 35 minutes, and Kyle Barrett seemed to go down there as he tussled with Aaron Galland and certainly seems to be in pain. And the Tipperary players didn't like the challenge. Todd O'Dwyer is going across to have a word with his linesman to get further information. Gerard Hegarty is clearly letting his feelings be known. That's Cathal McAllister from here in Cork, who's a top-class referee as well, acting as linesman this afternoon. And Todd O'Dwyer has the book out, but let's see what's going to happen here. He's definitely going to have a word with Aaron Galland.
Yeah, he was struggling to win the free mark, trying to get away, and at the last, when the free was given, he swung back to hurl and hit Cathal Barrett. Depends what the linesman told the ref. We haven't seen a replay of it yet here, but he's certainly going to take his damage. Could be a red.
What colour is the card? Looks like it's going to be yellow. Yellow card for Aaron Galland at the start of this second half, which is never a good way because immediately you're under a little bit of pressure.
So it's fouled there, watch this, and he swung back. That's a red card, in my view, all day long.
And Aaron Galland and Todd Dwyer having a further conversation. Brendan Maher tussling with Peter Casey. So in your view, Michael, Aaron Galland looking to still on.
Straight red.
Meanwhile, Tipperary win themselves a free. They are so determined.
Yeah, he won the free, Marty, fair enough, and he was pulled back, but you can see after the free is given and Kyle Barrett's going to stop, he swung back to her. So the rule is striking or attempting to strike, red card. And once he gave the yellow, I can't see how he didn't give a red.
Barry Hogan, meanwhile, takes the free. Dropping it up as Seamus Cannon comes in. Ball hops kind of with a Tipperary on, but it's going to dribble over the end line and wide. There was a real opportunity there for Jake Morris.
Well, I mentioned the sun in the first half. It definitely caught Sean Finn there. He couldn't see the ball. He missed it in the air, and Jake Morris had a chance there to stick it in the net.
Barry Nash down towards Keane Lynch. Marking is very tight. Little or no space. It's been the mark. Sends it up in towards the Limerick 45 metre line. Dara O'Donovan and Dan Morrissey just a little bit hesitant, to say the least, in their delivery. Keane Lynch has lost his hurley. And Todd Dwyer, I think Keane Lynch decided that was going to be a free before Todd Dwyer did.
Yeah, I think it was a free, to be fair. I think Limerick, just see that Dara in again there, that's fair. He's trying to hold him up, but he's affected him playing the ball. And just felt in the first half, Limerick could have got a couple of more frees. You know, I think they had to work that bit harder for the frees. No bearing on the game, because Tipperary were so impressive. But certainly Limerick supporters not happy at halftime.
Dermot Burns has scored 2 points in the first half. One from a free and one from play. Adds to his collection and starts to reduce down Tipperary's lead. Tackle from Barry Hogan. Cody Maher is making himself available, but Barry decides to go long again. Seamus Cannon comes out to gather it, just leaves it behind him. Darrow Donovan. Again, great marking by Tipperary. Seamus Cannon recovered, kept chasing and harassing, putting Limerick under pressure. Comes out for his Tom Morrissey, and that sails between the posts. Point Ivara Kuig for Tom Morrissey, and his fourth from play.
Yeah, and that's more like it from Limerick. That's what they like to do. A couple of short passes on the middle. Morrissey moved off. Will O'Donoghue spotted him. Lovely ball out to him and over the bar. That's the way they like to work it. They have an extra man at the back there now. They're starting to work that ball down.
Puck out is again a long one. Seamus Cullen almost was through it. Good defending by Limerick. William O'Donoghue. Hand pass well controlled by Garrod Hegarty. Good wrist work. Has the vision to see who was running outside. It's Dermot Burns. Cuts inside. And away goes Burns. Being pursued by Seamus Kennedy and Noel McGrath. Into the centre towards Keane Lynch. High challenge. And when Limerick start running at the Tipperary defence, it causes trouble with a capital T.
Yeah, that's the way they normally play. To work the ball through the lines. You can see the high. That's going to be a yellow card, no doubt about that. But, you know, Tipperary to keep up that pace from the first half is always going to be hard. And Limerick are great champions. They're not going to go down without a fight. So we're set up now for a mighty second half. It should be down to 8 points now after this. Or seven.
It was 10 at the break. As Aaron Galland stands over this with his first free of the day since being introduced for Graham Mulcahy towards the end of the first half. Warm round of applause indicates that that has reached its target. Limerick in the second half have already notched up 3 points. Tipperary yet to score. 7 points between the teams. Good ball into the centre. Good catch by Brendan Maher. But now Limerick are doing what Tipperary did in the first half. Chasing and harassing. Still Brendan down on his knees trying to put in the challenge. Good work by Tom Morrissey to Garrod Hegarty. Here's a chance. Here's a shot. Oh! It rebounds. Back in the net. Seamus Flanagan from Fianna Castlemark scores a goal like what he did against Tipperary in the championship last year in the wind and rain. He does it in the glorious sunshine. Same venue, same place. Cracking goal.
What a save from Barry Hogan first, but Seamus Flanagan, like all great forwards, following up, flicks it into the net, down to 4 points. It's just what I suppose Limerick have dominated since half time. They've got to grips with Tipperary's tactics. Paul Clerick obviously busy at half time, and it's all Limerick since the half time break. 1-3 to no score since they came back out.
4 points between the teams. It was only 8 minutes ago. Tipperary need to find their mojo again, find their rhythm. If that ball is sent in under pressure off the stick of Dan McCormack, the ball is wide. I wonder what he's thinking right now. Dan Morrison, Barry Nash. He's already thinking what he was going to do with the ball once he got it. Gives it over towards Sean Finn. Long ball up towards Seamus Flanagan and Aaron Galland. Tipperary win the possession. Free, at least it should be, for Tipperary.
Yeah, much more urgency about Limerick. You can see them pressing up, probably overplayed that one. Here's Hegarty coming in with the trip, and definitely a free, but Tipperary after being stunned, I think, by that opening from Limerick in the second half. Jason Ford coming back a long way to take this one. No huge change in any of the matchups or anything like that, but just Limerick have just started with way more urgency, and the biggest thing is they're not playing that long ball in, they're playing the ball the way they're comfortable playing it through the length.
Just looking at the replay of the goal, That was some save by Barry Hogan just previous. As the free is dropped in, ball is wide. Which it was, Martin. We now have 12 wides.
Sorry about that save. It was brilliant. You see the way he angled her. The ball would have flown out the field, but Flanagan was following through and stuck it in the net.
Keen Lynch lays it off first. Kyle Higgs. Great hook by Michael Breen. Stayed with him. Referee has given a free. And it's going to Limerick. Created by the determination of one Kyle Hayes.
Yeah, and a couple of things to look out for there. First of all, the little flick pass from Keane Lynch. But then Kyle Hayes, he's not used to somebody staying with him. Michael Breen had the taste to stay with him. He was so surprised he was hooked, but he had the power to win it back. And he was held up by the two arms and fouled. And a tough free in the sideline here from Galan, but obviously hugely important again. And you'd expect him to knock it over.
Patrick Swellman, Aaron Galan. Difficult angle, but it wasn't a problem for him at all. His presence on the field is certainly making an impact.
You're 100%, Marty, massively. I think whatever was going on, he wasn't ticked, maybe lack of form, but he got a kick up the backside and it's working. He is full of life since he came in.
Long ball, as Tipperary have yet to score in the second half. He's back about to change. The white flag is raised. And Tipperary, happy enough with that score from Jake Morris. They need it.
That sun is a huge factor now in the Limerick defenders' eyes. Nobody knew where that ball was, and Morris picked it up and tapped it over.
Great catch. Keane Lynch trying to get away from Dan McCormack, and Dan McCormack is fouling. And Limerick are doing the chest pumps, the high fives. They are highly motivated in the second half. And Tipperary will have to produce the same level and intensity as they did in the opening 35 minutes.
Well, I think they're under serious pressure. Keane Lynch now is dominating Dan McCormack, and he's on a yellow, Dan McCormack. That's another foul. He's one foul away from being off, so Tipperary are going to have to make the decisive move there, I think, and get Dan McCormack off Keane Lynch, because Lynch is really thundering into the game.
4 points between the teams right now. It's Aaron Galan. Bends, lifts and strikes in one sweeping moment, and that is over the bar for his fourth. 3 point game again. 2:17, 1:17. 11 minutes into the second half. The All-Ireland champions have taken on the challenge, and they're showing a bit of character in this second half. And they're certainly upsetting the Tipperary boys. As passes goes astray. Keane Lynch laying it off to William O'Donoghue. As Limerick bear down on goal, it's big Garode Hegarty trying to pull the trigger. Great defending by Tipperary. Garode Hegarty has gone down, and Tipperary come away with it. Going across is Jason Ford. Sean Finn should have the situation under control. Flicks it over towards Kyle Hayes. Acres of Parky Creeve in front of him. Decides to use the slither and put it into the space. Aaron Galan would do very well to reach that. Just hit it a little bit too powerfully.
There's too much on it. I don't know how they're doing it. They're keeping up the pace of the game. What a block by Cathal Barrett there on Garrod Hegarty. The bravery he came across made a super stop. But the thing is breaking down now for Tip on the puck out, and Tom Morrissey should be over the bar.
That's exactly what he's done. It's his 6th point in the match. And the All-Ireland and Munster champions have come to life in the second half. 10 points, the difference at the break. It's now down to 2, 12 minutes into the second period.
Yeah, and they've picked off the last few Tipperary puckouts. Keane Lynch, the previous one. Tom Morrissey with 5 from play. Anything Jason Ford can do, Tom Morrissey can do in the second half.
Beautifully won by Jamie Callan. Coming across is Barry Nash. Never took his eye off the ball. Good catch. Lays it off. Ball into the space from Darragh Donovan. Aaron Galan. Dropping it, and it's over the crossbar. Aaron Galan with his 5th point of the game. He was only introduced a few minutes before the break, and he has certainly made his presence felt.
Well, look, his ability in the air, we all know about it, but look at that. Just enough on it to drop it over the bar. He's been brilliant. Limerick are showing now. Look, this is the performance we saw in Croke Park last December in the Ireland final. They're back to their best there in the second half.
Limerick have scored a goal and 7 points. A goal and 7 points in the second half. Tipperary responded with just one. That statistic alone will give you the difference between the two teams in this second period. Keane Lynch pops it up far as Kyle Hayes. That seemed to hit Seamus Kennedy in the side of the face, and I hope he's all right. He seems to be, to his great credit. And that is a sideline ball. That's the great advantage of wearing helmets in this game. Sideline ball. Not too sure what part of the wire is. Oh, he wants to take it again, as Seamus Kennedy rightly, absolutely, deserves the medical attention that he deserves. Just get the slither on the side of the face and just making sure that he's able to continue on. Made his debut against the Cork Hurlers, actually, 5 years ago. And, great footballers, I mentioned as well, with Clonmel Commercials, plays his hurling with St Mary's. Really, really good player.
The big factor and rightly so. Look, the face guards obviously doing their job. We've seen many players over here getting those belts and be off, maybe a bad injury. So good to see Shane. He looks okay. Now, the subs are going to be the big thing now. Always are. There's the ball straight into the side of the head. Luckily, he's okay. But the subs now in the last 20 are going to make, it's going to be huge in this game. And Tipperary have a lot of potential on the bench. They're going to have to prove it now when they come on.
Darragh Donovan giving it short for us. William O'Donoghue. Beautifully robbed by Garrod Hegarty. He was on the stick momentarily of on the boss of Dan McCormack's hurling. The referee spotted an infringement and he's giving a free to Limerick.
It's just that work rate, that tenacity, that, you know, it was there in the first half and Tipperary were just savage, but Limerick had another gear and they were probably disappointed at halftime, but they've gone up that gear and they're winning those frees that they weren't winning in the first half now simply because they're swarming over the ball and they're putting in massive, massive effort in the second half.
1 point between the teams. They've only been level once before. This is going to be the first time actually they're going to be level if this goes over the bar. 119-217. This to level the match for the very first time. Aaron Gallagher sends the slither high and between those white posts down at the city end. A 10-point lead by Tipperary has been broken down in 16 minutes, which is impressive, considering the awesome display that we saw from Tipperary in the opening half.
Yeah, look, Keane Lynch gone to left half hour in the second half. Dan McCormack totally out of position on the right half position here now. Hegarty in the centre. All their moves are working. They're half back line powering into the game, and they've just taken over.
Comes out for his Tom Morrissey into the centre to his William O'Donoghue. Farris Seamus Flanagan. He's a fine hurler. He's a great target man, but he can score as well.
And Will O'Donoghue, Marty, his himself and Darragh Dunham, their work rate, and that kind of broke onto him, but straight away. And they weren't doing that in the first half. They took three or four shots that weren't on, but they're giving the right ball all the time now.
Ball breaks down towards Kyle Hayes. Tipperary rattled at the start of the second half, and they need a little bit of leadership now. And control. Keane Lynch sweeps in, had a slither momentarily. Sean Finn pumps it into the space. Peter Casey, lovely hurling, it really is. Now that is a classy point by a cheeky forward with an array of hurling skills. First the pickup, then the wrist work, then the balance, the shot, and Limerick add on another point from 10 points down at half time. Limerick people can cheer as they see the All-Ireland champions and Munster champions respond to the greatest challenge so far. 10 points down at the break, at the water break, we lead by two.
Marty, incredible. Look, we give Tip all the credit they deserve in the first half, but what can we say about Limerick since the restart? They've got their tactics so much right. They've been absolutely phenomenal. 110 to a point since the start of the second half. It's fantastic.
It's an interesting second half. Let's go straight down to the sideline for a man who's watching up close and personal. That's our Damien Lawler.
Yes, Marty, at halftime, the Tipperary players were greeted by huge applause from their own management team. This time around, it's the Limerick sideline team that have come out to applaud their team for a remarkable turnaround from the break. Just before half-time, John Coyley was screaming at his players, screaming, run at them, run at them. And in fairness to Limerick in the second half, that's exactly what they've done. And as you say, Martin, they've gone from 10 down to being 2 up. Tipperary are not pressing the panic button just yet. They've just introduced Willie Connors. Their management team of Eamon O'Shea, Dara Egan and Liam Sheedy have just had a confab here in front of us, and they're about to bring in Paddy Cadell as well. So all to do as we hand back to you, Martin.
Just in case you've just turned on your television, and just give you a quick recap. At half-time, Tipperary, the scoreline was Tipperary 2-16, Limerick 12 points. But then Limerick have responded, and they got this goal after a brilliant save from Barry Hogan. Ari Gallan took a rasper of a shot. This came after 42 minutes, and it was a fantastic save by the keeper. As Aaron Gallan was calling for it, here comes the shot. Hogan, brilliant save, but look who was waiting for it. Seamus Flanagan.
Yeah, look, it's back down to doing what they do so well. They're going short, short, then they're going long on occasion. In the first half, they were going long a lot. They weren't getting much, but maybe again, look, they're so fit. They're so, like, they're still a young team, a relatively young team. Very, very fit, very mobile, and look, great mental strength to come out in the second half, being 10 points down at half-time. We've seen that a lot in hurling over the years. Like, I think I said it with you, Marty, here a few years ago, 9 points at the end is leading hurling. Like, we're seeing it again today.
Absolutely, Mike. Short little puck out, then goes long, but Limerick have taken control in the second half. And Kyle Hayes, now beginning to see acres of Parky Queen, and away he goes. He started in his own half, hopping the sniffer twice in the hurling, taking a shot. Oh, my word! A fantastic goal! Goal of the year! And it's only July! That was just incredible! Started with Keane Lynch, popping it up to Hayes. Off he went on his motorbike. He couldn't be stopped. And watch the finish. Unstoppable. Fantastic.
And Marty, if you look at his hurl, it's turned the wrong way around as well. What a goal. I don't think I've ever seen a goal like that. That is Kyle Hayes. That is what he can do. I don't think there's any other hurler I've ever seen that could do that. Get a ball that far out. He was going to be hooked. He sliced through the middle. That's an unbelievable finish by an absolutely savage hurler.
5 points in front now, Limerick. And Kyle Hayes, who made one or two of those surging runs in the first half. But that was just an unbelievable cameo. To get the ball inside his own 45 from Keane Lynch and took off.
Yeah, and Martin, to think that he only went back, wing back, yellow there for Flanagan. He only went back, wing back when Dan Morrissey got injured last year. And the difference it's made to Limerick's play. Dan Morrissey went back at the fullback. Mike Casey was out, Richie English was out last year injured, and then they switched the team around. And when Dan went out of wing back, he went back. But he brings that. Look, we saw it against Cork the last day. We saw it last year in the All-Ireland final, Martin. Remember that run up the field? I said that day it could have been the best goal I ever saw in Cork Park. But he's done it there now. That is a goal for the ages. There's no doubt about it.
Watch this. Hopping the slither on the ground and then using the short grip powerfully to beat a fine goalkeeper and Barry Hogan. This was just magic from Kyle Hayes.
And I thought in real time, he's actually, the boss of his hurl had turned around, so he actually hit it with the boss of the hurl upside down as well, and still got huge power. And what a goal.
Tipperary are making the changes. Niall O'Mara is in. This is Mark Keogh that we're looking at, and Niall O'Mara as well, and also number 18 is Paddy Cadell, as the changes are now being made by Liam Sheedy. It's an emotional roller coaster ride for Liam Sheedy, because when you think of that moment when he was applauding his team going in, they looked in control. And this second half performance by the champions is just so impressive. And they're getting no change whatsoever out of the Limerick defence in this second half. 4 or 5 hand passes to get them out of trouble. Here comes the fifth as Darrow Donovan is back there. Goes long as Tipperary should have that situation under control, as Aaron Gallan was up there more or less on his own. Carl Barrett spraying it across towards Tórig Mar. Can Tipperary resurrect their chances? Seamus Kennedy dropping it in. Great work by Dan Morrissey. What a substitute to have when you lose Richie English. All-star fullback, 2020. Peter Casey. It was almost in slow motion, but the magic was just there. But we're just waiting for it to happen. Wasn't that just a thing of beauty?
It's beautiful, but look where it came from. Dan Morrissey looking up, picking out Will O'Callaghan for a fullback to be able to do that with a 50-yard pass straight into his hand. And he lobbed a little ball over the top to Casey making the move. And that's just a lovely score again. And this is, see the attack on the ball again there.
Tipperary haven't scored in the last 12 minutes. Pass is going astray, but still working out all right. They pump the ball in high, hoping maybe for a score from way out. And that's a fine effort, good effort indeed. And that is badly needed by Tipperary. And full credit to Willie Connors.
Yeah, and Willie Connors has been around the squad. Probably he'd like to be starting. He's been around for a few years now, but that's a good score. And Tipperary badly needed. That's only their second point in the second half. I don't think I've ever seen such a turnaround for a team that was so dominant with 2:16 in the first half to just score 2 points in the first 22 minutes of the second half.
Transformation in both dressing rooms is just hard to comprehend. And certainly, I'm not too sure what Liam Sheedy can do now because his team has given him everything. But certainly, he's thrown in the substitutes now to try and rearrange. He's Matt Shirkling is Brian McGrath from Lockmore Castellina, youngest of the McGrath brothers. He's now introduced as well. That's going off is Barry Heffernan. Changes in the Tipperary half back line.
And that sums it up. Barry Heffernan, super first half. Peter Casey has given him a bit of a run around the second, and that's just been the pattern of the match.
Tipperary go in pursuit of more scores. This ball is dropping to the right and wide. And Ford has hardly got a touch of the ball considering his magnificent performance in the first half with 10 points. That's no criticism of Jason, it's just the way the game has changed around. But I still have to think that Limerick were a bit fortunate to still have 14 players or 15 players on the field considering what Aaron Gillan is lucky to get away with. As Tipperary from a very difficult angle, again send the ball wide. 14 wides for Tipperary.
Yeah, that's Marco. Marty, I was going to say it there a second ago to you. Dan Morrissey and Aaron Gillan came on at the same time before halftime. The difference that both of them have made. Dan Morrissey has been rock solid. They started to change their style, but I'd agree with you. Aaron Gillan went off. This is a completely different game. You know, the lads will talk about more tonight, but to me it was a straight red card all day long. And Aaron Gillan's been hugely influential for Limerick in the second half.
Ball into the centre. Jason Ford stopped in his tracks on this occasion as much as he could by William O'Donoghue. Barry Nash attacked the slither but just bypassed him slightly. There's a chance here trying to get the ball anywhere near the goals. And Limerick are all over this again. And the referee, Paul O'Dwyer, is indicating he's going to give a throw ball on the 20-metre line. Dermot Burns slowly getting to his feet, but Tipperary have the possession back, not for very long, as the ball is sent back out again, and that one is dropping just to the wrong side of the post again.
Yeah, it's the pressure on the ball. You saw Tip in the first half, had so much time. Their tactics, their movement had Limerick all over the place, and they just, to give credit to their backroom team again, they assessed it at half-time, they made the necessary switches, they dropped Declan Hannan back a little bit deeper and they started working that ball out through their two midfielders, and you see Tom Morris especially going away.
This was the Aaron Gillan incident.
That's a straight red card, there is no doubt about that, and that's the turning point of the game. From that point of view, if he wasn't on, what would have happened? Limerick hurled so well anyway, but that's a red card.
And his influence has been huge since.
Yeah, and look, without him up there, his movement, his accuracy, his freeze, everything, you know, you don't know what would have happened. But you know, that's we don't like saying it, but that's, you know, that's what it is. The play had stopped. It was crazy what he did there, and he got away with it. And that's it. It's history now. And Limerick, you know, they're looking very, very comfortable. Still 10 minutes to go, but we're still, you know, Tipperary look to be out of ideas.
Tipperary scored 2 goals, 16 points in the first half, just 2 in the second period so far, as Gerard Hegarty sends this in, but it's tailing to the right and right.
Yeah, huge piece of skill there again by Hegarty. Flicked it up, the shot lost nearly on, he went for it. It was a mistake.
Oh, Seamus Flanagan bearing down on goal, going for it, and Barry Hogan deflects it, stood his ground well. I've been very impressed with this goalkeeper, I have to say, not just today, but since he got his place when Brian Hogan got injured. Barry Hogan has been absolutely outstanding in the Alliance League and deservedly gets his place in the Championship.
Brian Hogan, an all-star goalkeeper, you know, brilliant keeper, and to go in and... But you see the way he stood up there, as you said, Marty, so brave, so alert, the save he made earlier on, and maybe Flanagan should have tapped it over, but maybe Galan will, I presume. Is it Dermot Burns actually is coming up to take it?
Paul Kinnerk with the cap on there, with Alan Cunningham and John Kiley, is Limerick obviously going to make more changes. Dermot Burns, meanwhile, will take this 65. He's already scored 3 times in this Munster final, 2 of them for frees. First 65 for Dermot Burns. It is a successful voyage. And that increases the Munster champions and All-Ireland champions lead.
And they just don't look like missing. Now, we talked about them at half-time, hitting wides and, you know, they're out of the game. It's just the confidence. It's just amazing, the transformation.
Ball batted down. Tipperary have the possession once more. Good work by centre-half forward Michael Green. Finish, a disappointment once again.
And that's 2 or 3, you know, easy chances, Marty. Tipperary after missing there. Knock over those couple of chances, they're right in this game. It's nearly as if they've ran out of ideas, that they've been just gobsmacked. They're bamboozled by what Limerick have put on, the exhibition Limerick have put on.
David Reedy just came on the field for Darragh Donovan, gets his first touch, feeds Cian Lynch onto Gerard Hegarty. David Reedy had continued on with a run into space, but Gerard Hegarty sends this over his left shoulder. That's a brilliant point. Great score by last year's Hurler of the Year. Beginning to find that form again at exactly the right time.
And it's all true, Lynch. What a link, man. What a hurler.
Gerard Hegarty's second point of the match. Into the centre towards Ronan Maher. That's looking good. And Ronan Maher has scored a point against Clare in the semi-final. Gets his point in the Munster final. 6 points between the teams. Barry Nash. Going towards Tom Morrissey. Had enough guile and stickwork to be able to lay it off towards David Reedy, and David Reedy puts it between the posts. From a little club called Dumanalaka, had a bit of time playing hurling with Kildare, and transferred back to his native county again. Played very well in the league, actually, so I'm sure that John Kiley was very pleased with him, thus he's getting a run in this Munster final. Tipperary trying to engineer something. Robbie Hanley was involved there, giving it back, and that's a fine effort for Michael Bray. He scored a goal and a point against Clare, a point in the Munster final. Conor Boylan is being introduced by John Kiley, and the player that's going off is Tom Morrissey, having scored 6 points in the final. Peter Casey chasing this, good defending, however. And Tipperary, pressure is not gone by any means, and Casey has it once more. Back out for Gerard Hegarty. Floating it in, floating it inside the post. Classic.
Marty, look where he is. Like he was out on the right half forward position there 30 seconds ago. He's travelled across the field in a hot day like today, a couple of minutes to go. And that sort of movement, the teamwork again, Casey with a lovely little underarm pass.
Tipperary with the possession. Jason Ford wanted to lay it off quickly. But again, Kyle Hayes put in the pressure. Jason Ford from way out, showing leadership again, and gets his first point in the second half to make it a personal tally of 11. And Tipperary now have 221, 227. 3 minutes to go. Limerick introduced Pat Ryan. In the second half, Limerick have accumulated 2 goals and 15 points to Tipperary's 5 points. The figures tell the story, really. It's an amazing transformation. Declan Hannah, back for his Keane Lynch. Good work by Jake Morris. Making an angle for himself, but he fouled the possession by holding it too many times. Free to Limerick.
Yeah, he done all the hard work, caught it 3 times. I mentioned the substitutions there. Tom Morris and Seamus Flanagan got off. What games the two of them had. You know, 1-3 from Flanagan, 5 points from play, and a free from Morrissey. And just, you know, really, particularly Morrissey when they weren't going well, and Flanagan never stopped working, kept him in the game. And, you know, that's the leaders that this team, you know, Lynch has been awesome as well. But those two lads really put the shoulder to the wheel when the game was going against them.
Robbie Hanley going to be introduced. Six points between the teams. Keane Lynch is fine and is able to continue on. So the free are going to be taken by Dermot Burns. Captain of the under 21 team that won the All Ireland in 2015. And unusual for him. Sends that right and wide. The sunshine might have been a factor there. As Limerick introduce Robbie Hanley. The player that's going off is Keane Lynch to a warm standing ovation. That people who are from Limerick fans who are here at this upper level in the stand here in Parker Creeve.
Pure stylist, man. What a hurler, what a work rate, what an athlete. You can't, there's no fault in that man's game. He's just in everything he gives for that jersey.
I'm ready when you are.
4 added minutes in this Munster final. Passing going astray, but Tipperary recover. Robbie Hanley was putting in the challenge. It's going to be a free for Tipperary.
Yeah, Marty, still a few minutes to go. But, you know, for Limerick, 33, 4, 5, and 6, they won 4 in a row. They haven't won 3 in a row since. This is huge for them, for this team to make their own history.
Great work by William O'Donoghue. Having lost the possession, his perseverance, and you can see he just picked up an injury there. Still crouched on his knees off camera. This is Pat Ryan. Getting away from Tipperary defence. He has the support, Conor Boylan, and this man, Peter Casey. And that's the result. Peter Casey with his 3rd point of the game.
Yeah, look, at just again, these lads, Pat Ryan, the pace to bring them off the bench, you know, and lads are wrecked out there, and he's just straight down the middle, good vision, threw it outside, simple score.
Robbie Hanley trying to get away, make a little bit of space, trying to get away from Niall O'Mara. Aaron Gillan. Tipperary have the situation under control. Good work by Carl Barrett. Jason Fort waiting for it. As Owen Connolly gathered, sending it into territory there that's fairly crowded at the moment. Jake Morris sending it across. There's a chance here. Here comes the show. Wonderful. What a fantastic goal. Beautifully struck out by Mark Hill.
That's a great ball by Jake Morris. Brilliant first touch by Kyo. What a finish to the roof of the net. Still a couple of minutes to go here, Marty. Have we another twist in the tail? Who knows?
Absolutely brilliant goal. It's not every day of the week that Nicky Quaid is beaten three times. And you score 228. You score 321, I should say. And still possibly not win. 2 minutes to go in extra time. Limerick in front by four. Dermot Burns. Inside, just inside his own 45. Has a goal. That is off target for the 12th wide of the match from Liam Sheedy. It's been an emotional roller coaster, really, to be honest with you. Ball drops down. Oh, here's an opportunity perhaps, and Tipperary not giving up. Ball into the centre, gathered by Dan Morrissey. And Limerick play themselves out of trouble. David Reedy gets a touch. Goes long. Down first, Peter Casey. Saw the challenge coming in. Gets inside Ronan Maher. Still Peter Casey. Difficult enough angle. He flicks it between the posts from an acute angle and over the crossbar. Clever play. He really is a little magician when he's on fire. And he's displaying his bag of magical tricks here this afternoon. 4 points to the pace he has scored in this Munster final. Robbie Hanley is getting on a lot of balls since he's introduced from Kilmallock. Sideline ball to Pereira. We're hitting the 74th minute. And Limerick are about to be crowned Munster champions for the third year in a row. Barry Nash. Coolness personified is fouled. Getting to the ball. And the referee, Todd Dwyer, blows the full-time whistle. Limerick have achieved something that the county hasn't done in 85 years. Win three Munster titles back-to-back. They trailed by 10 points at half-time. 216 to 12 points. But whatever happened in that Limerick dressing room at halftime, it will be interesting. Alan Cunningham, Paul Kinnerk, Mike Kiley, and John Kiley thought out a plan, renewed the energy, because Tipperary were simply brilliant in the first half, scoring 2 goals and 16 points. But Limerick fought back magnificently, and goals by Seamus Flanagan and Kyle Hayes brought him very much into contention, and a goal by Kyle Hayes will be spoken about for a long time to come. And this is a day to remember for Limerick. Full-time score in Parky Creef Cork. Limerick, 2 goals, 29 points. Tipperary, 3 goals, 21. Limerick Munster champions for the third year in a row, 2019-2020-2021.
Thank you very much to Marty and of course to Michael Dagenham as well for commentary today, and Donalo Cusack, as we watch that out there today, putting aside the potential red cards that perhaps two Limerick players could have had in that second half, is there much else you could do rather than sit back and marvel at the fact that they were 10 points down at half time and by the first water break they were two ahead?
I think so, Joanne. I think that championship quarter, that third quarter, Limerick were as unstoppable as the tide in that. And a lot, or at times we hear people talking about maybe the described way Limerick are as being systematic, in some way boring and so on. But they're an outstanding team playing to a common method and a plan. And that's something that should be celebrated. this goal here was critical. Aaron Gillan, we'll talk about it in a minute. Like we said, we'll stay away from the red card at the moment. He was absolutely critical to it. Like all good forwards, they're following the play out and coming from behind. He's actually the player that causes the situation for Tipperary when they're under so much pressure. They don't know where to go. The game was going, even you could feel the game going against them before the end of the first half. He gets it side on, goes for goal, and the ball then breaks. Hogan obviously was unlucky, but Gillan key in every aspect of his movement in that sequence there to that goal.
And then Limerick started to get on top of Tipperary's puckouts, and Tom Morrissey, maybe had got criticism in the last number of weeks, was underperforming, but he was key to this comeback in the second half. And again, as Don Logue said, Gillan's influence in the second quarter, in that third quarter, was just immense. But like Limerick, it's hard to believe Limerick outscored Tipperary 217-15 in the second half. Tipperary got 216 in the first half, so it's hard to believe the scoring that Limerick did in the second half.
I think that man, Joanne, must take credit. I'm a little bit red from the sun, but red from embarrassment when I said Tip would win handy at half time. But he must take some credit, him and his management team, because they turned it around as well. You know, the players, it was just a privilege to be here, as Don Logue said. You know, to do that, you know, to win three in a row, Limerick haven't done since the 30s. It's called the Mick Mackey Cup. We never saw him, but he goes down in folklore of one of the best. But these players are going to be some of the best Limerick hurlers ever. And what they did in that second half, as Ursula's just alluded to, is just unbelievable. They're a credit to their families and all their clubs as well, of what they've achieved today.
And will inspire yes. generations of Limerick yep. players the way they're playing that game. And I'm really strong on that systematic thing that's kind of thrown as a negative towards them. It's bullshit. It's said by fellas who don't understand what they're talking about. They're a credit, the way they work together, the way they work towards...
And trust each other.
Trust
too.
Each other, yep. absolutely, Ursula.
You both said Limerick hurlers, they'll inspire Limerick hurlers, and they're some of the greatest Limerick hurlers of all time. Are they heading towards a different... Could you take out the adjective
oh,
there?
Oh, no, I think they'll inspire all hurlers. I was training this morning, and we were talking about the match last night, and we talk about it on Tuesday night, we talk about this performance, because we all look up to the champions, we all look up to the best, and that's what we all strive to be, so... I think a lot of counties are going to be shaking in their boots a bit after that second half performance. But look, I think we should all just look on in awe of what they've achieved. And that second half, in that heat, Joanne, and what they did was just brilliant.
And under Kiley's reign, look at 3 Munster titles, 2 All-Irelands, 2 League. You know, they look unstoppable at the moment. And I just think you have to stand back and admire them today.
And there's a wider organisation, Joanne. I tell you, it's an important point as well. What we saw there today was investment in a decade of proper strength and conditioning in young players. It's as anyone that's in the know knows that Limerick took a very professional approach how they were going to invest. And I will say, the likes of, you see Tipperary behind there, I definitely know Cork because they felt they knew better, right? And all of those things are secondary to being able to put the ball over the bar, we get it. But there's a wider organisation that deserves great credit looking at these images here today.
And look at that man there, because you said strength and conditioning, which we all know plays a huge part, and they're so good from that point of view. But skills wise, I mean, we marvel at the goal that this man scored there in that second half after the water break, soon after.
Yeah, and Michael Breen had done a great job in him for the first half. But here we go, and off he goes, and this is the physicality. But like, this is just this is an age, you know, this is something that's not developed. This is just something he has. He's 6'4", he's powering forward. And just the power he got in this strike. And we just track it. Here he is inside his own 45. And the minute Keane Lynch just immense in that second half. Just spots him, simple pass. And he just takes off. And he's just, only one thing in his mind, he's going for goal. And just a note here, he fixed the ball off the ground. Brilliant skill. But the power, Joanne, he gets in hitting that ball from above his shoulder. And when we show it at the end, he turns the hurl the wrong way. I think Michael referenced it in commentary. So to do that execution of that skill, it's just unbelievable, to be honest. And it was just, that was it, you know, that was the capping for the Limerick performance. And they're the kind of players that are inspiring the next generations.
And I know we keep going on about the heat here, but for him to do that in the 55th minute, having played 55 minutes under this sun, does that make it all the more spectacular?
That's it, and the energy in the second half that Limerick brought to this game, Tipperary weren't able to sustain that level. You know, they had given so much in that first half, but as Don Logue alluded to, that third quarter proved crucial again for Limerick.
And we are aware, of course, that Limerick could have only had 14 or possibly even 13 players on the pitch in that second half as well. And we'll be looking at that, and we'll be getting so much more reaction and analysis to a third in a row Munster title for John Kiely's and Paul Kinnerk's side, led once again by captain Declan Hannan. In his fifth year in charge, John Kiely has now led Limerick not only to two All-Ireland titles, but three Munster titles in a row as well. Great victory for them over Tipperary today, despite that brilliant start to the game for Tipperary. But let's get to what we mentioned before. Should they have had all 15 players on the pitch?
No, I think Aaron Gillan was very lucky. We see it here. He actually, you know, he's the fulcrum of attack, winning that ball up high. Did well to win a free off of Cottle Barrett, but there's no doubt about it. We see the replay. We see it in real time here. Barrett was holding him up. Yes, it was a free in, but it was a slap back. Reckless use of the hurl. He flicked back the hurl. No, he struck back with the hurl. And, yeah, that was a straight red card in anyone's language.
Now, we also had an incident, a later on incident as well, where they could have sent off...
Flanagan.
We thought it was Seamus Flanagan, yeah. But I was confused there because it wasn't Seamus Flanagan in the picture. But Jamie Flanagan could have gone as well.
Yeah, you know, and Limerick have probably got criticised in the past with the high challenges and the playing on the edge. He's probably very lucky as well. You know, the hurl came in very high on Padraig Marva. But look at Gillan and Flanagan had a huge impact in the second half. So Tip will probably feel slightly frustrated that the two of them stayed on the pitch.
Yeah, Tipperary are obviously going to be frustrated at that. They're going to be frustrated, obviously, with what happened in the second half. But what is there for them now? Are they still, though, contenders?
Tip won't point towards that. They'll know there was a much bigger difference in the teams than those potential sending offs. It's definitely an opportunity for improvement for Limerick, though, because if you look at those two incidents today, you look at Hagerty, they're definitely liberal and have been loose, and it's one of the things that could derail them. Anybody could be derailed, and that's turning into a bit of a pattern, because if Wright was right, Gillan was gone off the field at that stage. From a Tipperary point of view, they started well, they set up well, they knew what they were doing, which you'd imagine Tipperary obviously are going to do in a Munster final. But ultimately, they, on a food chain, you tend to poke those ahead of you or on top of you. And today, Tip poked a bear and got absolutely mauled.
Okay, well, let's hear from the boss of the Bears. John Kiely is with Damien.
John, congratulations. The Mackey Cup is going back to Limerick. Can you just tell me about your thoughts in that game? I know you're just off the pitch now, so it's quick.
Yeah, it's actually hard to reflect, really. It's just such an incredible game. You know, Tipperary, from the get-go, had us in real trouble in the first half. They stretched us every which way. You know, they had an extra defender at the back and we couldn't manage it. You know, they played the ball around really accurately and they were picking their scores off from every angle. So we were in real trouble, you know, at half-time. You know, we were lucky we weren't even further down at half-time. But I suppose, you know, we have great faith in our ability as a team. And, you know, we did a little bit of restructuring, but really it was about us, you know, getting stuck into it. You know, we were not physically engaged in the game and we needed to. And we tightened things up at the back. We committed ourselves to going at the ball. And, you know, we just chipped away 1 point at a time. We got our confidence up, you know, and as the gap closed, our confidence grew. And we could see that the opportunity was there for us to take it. You know, and we pressed on and the lads coming off the bench made a huge impact again. So really, really pleased with the effort today. You know, we had to overcome a lot of challenges today, you know. Going 11 points down against the class Tipperary team, it's no joke trying to come back against that.
Like, with your spirit and experience and mental strength, were they key reasons that you were able to get back in that game? Because you can't just flick a switch and get back into a match like that you were so badly beaten in the first half. But yet, from the outset of the second half, it seemed that it was just like that for Limerick.
No, and we spoke about it at half time. You know, listen, we knew we could still win the game at half time. We just needed to get into it from the very word go and just start hurling and start getting a couple of scores on the board, you know, and start stringing a few passes together and just physically engage in the game, you know. And once we started to do that, we never looked back.
The impact of Aaron Gillan and Dan Morrissey from the bench, an incredible impact from them.
Huge, huge. It's a 35-man job for us, you know. We had guys this morning in Kamalloch, you know, trained their backsides off for an hour who couldn't make the 26, you know. And it's about everybody bringing everything they can and it all adds up, you know. The lads on the pitch can't be as good as they are until Leicester boys on a Tuesday night and a Friday night put them to the sword and push them all the way so as they can do what they did here in the last quarter of an hour, you know. And
John Kiley there, always speaking with so much passion. Let's get to the man of the match, though, because we're running out of time. Who was it?
Well, look, in the second half, when Limerick really needed someone to stand up and be counted, that was Keane Lynch. He was at the heart of everything good that Limerick did in that third quarter. He won three massive frees and he set up Kyle Hayes for that wonder goal.
OK, let's hear from him now, because he's with Damien.
Keane, congratulations. A hat-trick of Munster titles for Limerick. What do you make of a game like that?
Ash, look, it's unbelievable, I suppose. Obviously, the occasion for the supporters of both sides to be able to come down here to Cork. Unbelievable, even seeing my own family getting up this morning, heading off to a match. It's something we've missed the last 18 months. And the battle there we had with Tip, you know, we're playing down through the years, we know each other so well. But look, thank God we come out on top. But great credit to the Tip lads for what they've done to continue to do. But I must put on a bit after sun after that.
I'd say you need a factor 50 for that, Keane.
Yeah.
Just in terms of being on the ground at pitch level, can you talk me through what happened in the first half and the second half? You went from being 10 down to winning that game. But on the ground, what happened, Keane?
I suppose Tip brought a massive work rate and they kept going and we couldn't come to grips with there for the first while. But luckily enough, after half time, we came out and things started to go our way and we just kept going and kept motoring on, and that's the secret, just keep going and keep plugging away.
I saw your manager encourage you to run more, run from deep more. Would that be what happened in the second half, do you think?
I don't know, no, personally. I suppose just the work rate out there in that heat is very hard to come by, and I suppose trying to get to the ball ahead of your man, it's hard enough doing a normal day, but today extra hard. But I suppose, look, the fans here, the crowd here and the people at home watching us, it's great to have some bit of normality back, and John, we'll enjoy this and be able to go home to meet our families later on, the supporters and the local people here. It's special, like, you know.
Congratulations, Keane. You're the Borgash Energy Man of the Match.
Thanks
well
very
done.
Much.